Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to Zion Joe Lutheran Church. We're happy to have you here with us today as we celebrate the sixth Sunday of Easter, and also we celebrate Mother's Day today as well. We begin with our introit. With the voice of singing, declare ye and tell this. Utter it even to the ends of the earth.
Hallelujah.
The Lord has redeemed his servant Jacob. Tender care.
Amen.
The word the Lord, how great and glorious His name is, worthy of praise.
Forever. Amen. Sing to the
people who do what the Word says, not people who only hear it. Such people are deceiving themselves. In fact, if anyone hears the Word and does not do what it says, he is like a man who carefully looks at his own natural face in a mirror. Indeed, he carefully looks at himself, then he goes away and immediately forgets what he looks like. But the one who looks carefully into the perfect law, the law of freedom, and continues to do so, since he does not hear and forget, but actually does what it says, that person will be blessed in what he does. If anyone considers himself to be religious, but deceives his own heart, because he does not bridle his tongue, this person's religion is worthless. The religion that is pure and undefiled in the sight of God the Father is this, to take care of orphans and widows in their affliction, and to keep oneself unstained by the world. This is the word of our God.
Thank you.
deceive yourselves. Do what it says. Anyone who listens to the word and does not do what it says is like a man who looks at his face in a mirror, and after looking at himself, he goes away and immediately forgets what he looks like. But a man who looks intently into the perfect law that gives freedom and continues to do this, not forgetting what he has heard, but doing it, he will be blessed in what he does. If anyone considers himself religious and yet does not keep a tight rein on his tongue, he deceives himself and his religion is worthless. Religion that God our Father accepts as pure and faultless is this, to look after orphans and widows in their distress and to keep oneself from being polluted by the world. This is the word of our God, brothers and sisters, in Christ Jesus. I have always traditionally gotten in trouble on Mother's Day. And the reason I always get in trouble on Mother's Day is not because I forget to buy flowers or a card for my mother or for my wife, but usually I get in trouble with you people. Because this is a day that a lot of people bring their mom to church, and they are expecting of me, usually, that I'm going to have some sort of mother-centered worship service. And quite honestly, I just don't think about it. I simply go by the pericope that we are at. These are the lessons appointed. And without fail, every year, somebody says, don't you have more mother-focused stuff? But I've broken the cycle. I've broken it this year because as it happens, not by any planning on my part, but the lessons for this sixth Sunday of Easter perfectly coincide with Mother's Day as an application. They perfectly talk about what it means to actually live our resurrection faith. And there is no more fitting example, expression of our resurrection faith than how we treat our mothers. And what James exhorts us today in this text that I just read to you is that we don't merely say we're Christians. We don't merely hear about Christianity, we actually put it into practice. In other words, a Christian son, a Christian daughter, is not a philosopher. But they're someone who takes to heart what they believe so that they can live their faith out. Now, I'm going to be very clear about who James is aiming at in these words. James is not aiming at the openly immoral, the openly sinful in our community. That's not who he's aiming at. He's not talking to the people who are out hanging out at the bar at 2 in the morning. He's not talking about the people who break into the bank. He's not talking about people who are doing all those bad things we like to point. All those people that we, like church people, like to point out and say, I'm glad I'm not like them. That's not who James is talking about. James is talking about you. And me. James is talking about people who on the outward look like good Christians. He's talking about people who, yes, show up in church, and they know when to stand and when to sit, and they can say their Lord's Prayer, and they know their catechism, and they know how to sing the hymns. In fact, they might even sing them quite well. That is James is talking about here. He's talking about people who understand the history of Christianity and the forms of Christianity, and even go so far as to keep those forms quite well. But what James is pointing out today is if you think that is being a Christian, you've missed the point. This is very evident on Mother's Day. Now in California, where I served the previous 9 years of my ministry, Mother's Day was kind of bittersweet for me. It was sweet because, man, the church was packed on Mother's Day. The only other service during the year that had as many people come was Easter Sunday. Everybody came to church on Mother's Day with their mother, and they showed that they still hadn't forgotten all those things they had learned in Lutheran grade school so many years ago. They were so proud to stand and sit. You could even almost look at the faces of the kids with their mother say, hey, look at me, Mom, I remember. See, Mom, I remember how to do all that stuff with catechism and confirmation all those years ago. That was the sweet part, that I got to preach to a church full of people. The bitter part was when I knew that most of them would not be back until the next Mother's Day. And it's not as though they live in Washington or Oregon or Arizona. They live, most of which, within walking distance of the church. What's the problem? The problem is that they are people who know the word, but they do not take it. taken to heart. They are people like James describes today, who hears the word, but does not do what it says. He looks at himself, at his own natural face in the mirror. He carefully looks at himself and then goes away and immediately forgets what he looks like. But he's telling to all of us, like, puff ourselves up, because we know our Apostles' Creed, and because we know our Lord's Prayer, and because we can recite even many Bible passages and hymn verses from memory. What he's saying to all of us who today are feeling pretty good about ourselves because we ordered in advance our flowers and our corsages, and we got everything we need to make sure that checklist of Mother's Day is done, he's saying, God doesn't care about the outward appearance. God cares about the heart. In other words, brothers and sisters in Christ, faith is not faith unless you have taken it personally. Think of what Jesus says in the Sermon on the Mount. Not everyone who says, Lord and Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only he who does the will of my Father. In fact, Jesus goes on in that statement, which is really quite terrifying. He says, Lord, didn't we do miracles in your name? And he will say to them on that day, I never knew you. It is quite clear on the pages of Scriptures that one of the most dangerous things in our life is for us to know the Word of God, not take it to heart. To know the Word of God, but never let it penetrate our soul. To never really say this. But if there is one thing that your mother should have taught you, and did teach you, was that there are not to be two different kids. Not one kid outside and one kid inside the home. There shouldn't be one face to the public, one face to your teacher, one face to your employer, and one face to me. There should always be one person. In fact, if you go back to your childhood, when was the time that your mother was most disappointed with you? She was most disappointed with you when you stopped being the person that she thought you were and that she had raised you to be. Don't you remember those words ringing in your ears as kids? That's not how I raised you. That's not the kid I know. Imagine those words are magnified 1,000 times over when our Heavenly Father says that to us, who has baptized us, who has brought us into faith, who has redeemed us by the blood of His Son, Christ Jesus. We need to take these words personally. We need not merely to hear them, but to say this most important word. What is God saying to me with these words? I think King David does a wonderful job for all of us in his Psalms, because the Psalms are the most beautiful book of taking faith and making it personal. David thinks about what God says. He thinks about God's law. He thinks about those Ten Commandments as applied to him. In Psalm 51, David's great penitential psalm, he says, Lord, against you, you only have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight. Now, what David is not saying there is, I haven't sinned against my mom or my dad or my wife or my kids. What he's saying first and foremost is, when I've done all of those things, the first person I sinned against was you, God. Whenever I talk back to my mom, whenever I talk back to my kids, I was sinning against you first, because these gifts you placed in my life. You could have given me any mom in the world, you could have given me any kid in the world, but you, before time and eternity, made sure that this would be my mother, and these would be my children. And when I took them for granted, when I did not listen to them, I was despising you. David understood that our first debt of sin is his debt to God, and he took it to heart. But more importantly, David was saying, I take your gospel seriously too. I take it seriously when you say, create in me a new heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. Do not cast me away from your presence. I take it to heart when you say to me that you have provided a Savior for my sins. And when I look at the face of Jesus, I am not detached from his pierced hands and his pierced feet and his pierced side. Those are the wounds that he suffered for me and for these sins that I have committed. Many years ago, a great preacher by the name of Martin Lloyd-Jones shared a story that he had in his ministry of a young parishioner who he had known for many years since he was just a little boy. As he had grown up in the church and now a full-grown man, he was talking to Pastor Jones at the end of his ministry. And he said, "You know, when I was a little kid, I came to listen to you because I didn't have a choice. This is what we did on Sunday. Whether I liked it or not, Mom and Dad took me and sat me in the pew. I thought you preached too long. But as I got older, I started listening to what you said, Pastor Jones, and I thought, you know, there's a lot of interesting things that you're saying to me, and there are things I can use in my life. There are things I can use to win an argument at my school. There are things I can use to make sure that I think correctly about God and know His Word well, and I really am like that. But you know, now that I'm a man with children of my own, I've come to the realization that all along, those first two things didn't mean a hill of beans. That from the very beginning, the only reason these words were preached to me is so that I might take them personally, that this is what Jesus is saying to me. That every time I walk into a church and sit in a pew, God is actually talking to me, to my life, to my heart. We're not here to do a checklist, people. We are not here out of habit or social convention. We are here to take to heart Jesus speaking to us and to cherish every one of His words in the depths of our soul. But as James goes on to say to us today, if we take those words and put them in the depths of our soul, we cannot help it if those words come out of our mouth and our hands and our feet and our mind. And James goes on to say, if anyone considers himself to be religious but deceives his own heart because he does not bridle his tongue, that person's religion is worthless. Now, James is very brutally honest. He's one of the most honest of all people in the New and Old Testament. That's saying something. James doesn't sugarcoat anything. And what he's saying to all of us today is that if we have taken these words of Jesus, our relationship with Him seriously, then there cannot be any contradiction with how it comes out of our heart. In other words, James talks about three very basic points that show that we've taken the words to heart. We will know that we've taken the words to heart when we see it in our mouth. We'll know we've taken those words to heart when we see it in our charity. And we'll know we've taken those words to heart when we see it in the choices that we make in this life. Now, let me use the English teacher for an example. An English teacher is always very, very specific with what language we use, how we say things, how we write things, how we communicate things. And they do that not because they're picky people. They do that because they understand quite basically that as someone speaks, so they are thinking. That speech is nothing more than thought made evident. And James is making the same point here. If you've truly taken to heart Jesus Christ in your life, then it's going to show in what you say. A spring cannot give both fresh water and salty water. And there is no greater sincerity of our religion than how we talk. Not only how we talk to our moms, but how we talk to everybody. I remember I once had a lady in one of my congregations. She was a lady who was quite free with her language. Let me put it to you that way. And she was quite free with her opinions. And while there is nothing wrong with that in and of itself, she could also be quite judgmental with those opinions. And quite angry and quite mean even at times. And there were times that she would just go off and let anything. And she always covered up, no matter what she said, by saying, "I just have to call it the way I see it." And finally, one day, I just had enough. I had enough with it, and I said, "Can you tell me where there is a distinction between being loving and being honest and being tactful? Did you ever think that perhaps calling it the way you see it, if you cause nothing but hurt and heartache and people to feel mad and never come back into this church, perhaps you're not saying things in the way Christ your Lord would have you say them? What are you saying about Jesus if you sing beautifully here in the sacristy, but then go out and use every four-letter word that you can think of? And even if you don't use those four-letter words, what happens if you are people who, yes, you love and are so picky and precise about what version of the Lord's Prayer, what version of the Mighty Fortress of Our God we're going to sing in the sanctuary, and yet you have no trouble gossiping and slandering anyone in this world? Think about that. St. Paul says in the book of Romans that God's name is blasphemed among the nations because of us. Because the way we distinguish between what we say in these four walls and what we say everywhere else. There cannot be that distinction. A Christian does not have to each his own attitude. He does not have one face he wears and one mouth he wears and one language he wears here and then one he wears everywhere else. And if that is the case, then that person needs to be admonished and be told the harsh reality in your religion is worthless. But it goes beyond that. It goes beyond just watching what we're saying if we're taking the words of Jesus to heart. If we're not using our tongue to comfort and to console, to preach and to pray. We also got hands and feet. We also have wallets. And what are we doing with our hands and our strength and our money and the gifts we have? Are we just hoarding them for ourselves? Or are we using the gifts that God has given us to the most vulnerable in our society, in our church, in our community? Remember, when James writes these words, there is no such thing as a social welfare net. In fact, such a thing was impossible for James even to comprehend. And why was it impossible for James to comprehend? How could any of us here today go to sleep at night if we knew one of our members was laying out in the street? How could any of us look at ourselves in the mirror and call ourselves a Christian if one of our very members, one of our persons, we say, oh, you're a member of our church. Oh, you're our brother or sister in Christ, and we're going to let you sleep in the gutter? We're not going to make sure you are warm and well-fed. It's not an accident, brothers and sisters, that the church has traditionally created places for kids that nobody else in the world wanted. It's not a crazy thing that we have created educational institutions and hospitals because it is an outpouring of the love we have, not only for our own fellowship, but the world. Our charity should be the first thing people think about when they think about us. In fact, isn't that the reason why you love your mother so much? Isn't it the reason why this day is so special to you? Because it is a good day, is it not? For you to remind just how much your mom gave to you. Just how much they put up with you. Think about what you were. Think about how many times you rolled your eyes and didn't respect them. Think about how many times you called them the most worthless things in the world. These are the people who gave you life, who fed you and clothed you and didn't receive a dime from you in return. In fact, many times they didn't even receive a thank you. And yet I can say absolutely true, I am a pastor today because of my mom. I can say today I'm the man I am today because of my mom, who loved me as Christ Jesus loved me, and that's why it's not too much to buy flowers and call your mother. In fact, it's not too much if you gave everything just to say thank you for all the emotional, psychological, and spiritual blessings that Christ Jesus poured out on you in such great measure you have a hard time beginning to know how to even catalog all. The very last thing that James talks to us today about is this. Keep yourself unstained by the world. I think the last blessing our mothers gave to us, and the one that I very much, is the ability to see and make good decisions. And I think one of the most wonderful things that Christian mothers teach us is how to know what road to go down and what road not to go down. To keep oneself unstained by the world. We live in a world where it's so easy. In fact, you all have in your pocket this morning something where you can go down a road that is completely opposite of everything you see and hear and were taught anytime you wish. But friends, we should not only be Christians when people are watching us. We should be Christians when people are not watching us. We shouldn't only be Christians when we're around the dinner table, we're saying grace over the meal, or at a family occasion, or when we're here at church week. We should be just as much a Christian in the quiet of our own office, the emptiness of our house, driving down the road. I'm glad that all of you are in church today. I sincerely am. And I'm glad that all of you are honoring your mother in so many different ways. It's a beautiful thing to see. But I can honestly say this, speaking for all the mothers in the church today, and for having buried a mother just yesterday, that your mother would be happily forego all the cards and all the flowers and all the shows of bravado for the sure and certain hope that you love Jesus as much as she does. That you love Christ, who loved you first. And I promise you this, if you drink as deeply from the well your mother drank, at the well of Christ's sacrament, the well of Christ's word, the well of Christ's love, I promise you that that love will never be taken away from you. And the Bible says there are three great things. There's faith, hope, and love in this world. But the greatest is love. Do you know why? Because that's the one thing that doesn't pass away. The love that Christ pours out on us, we get to store up in heaven so that when we go to heaven one day, it is nothing but eternal love, eternal joy. That's the best gift that any of us could give to ourselves, and that's the gift that Christ gave to you through your mother. Celebrate that today. Amen. Would you please stand? We now confess our Christian faith according to the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things are made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became fully human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who in unity with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and life of the world to come. Amen. We offer a few intercessory prayers today. First, we pray on the behalf of the family of Delmar Bussler, and especially for his wife, Beverly Bussler. Delmar was called home to his Lord yesterday, and we will keep the family in our prayers. We also pray for Gavin Shook, who is the grandson of Connie and Jeff Kajeski. He's suffering complications in his cancer treatment, so we pray with him as well. We also pray on behalf of our members, Rose and Lori Milner, who are suffering illness at this time. O Lord God, Lord of life and death, we thank you for the mercy with which you blessed our fellow believer, Delmar Bussler, now fallen asleep. We thank you especially for having brought him to the knowledge of your Son, Jesus Christ. We pray that you would comfort his family, especially his wife, Beverly, and all else who mourn his death, precious promises, and sheer hope of a reunion in heaven. Grant his body rest and last, together with all of us, a joyful resurrection to life everlasting. Teach us to number our days aright, that we may gain hearts of wisdom, and finally be saved through Jesus Christ. First, the Lord and Savior, you have promised to be with believers everywhere in all circumstances of life. May this assurance and abiding presence comfort and sustain your servant Gavin Shook as he faces and undergoes surgery. Remove all anxiety and fear from his heart and lead him to rest all his confidence in you. Be with Gavin as he recovers and fill him with a divine thankfulness for your blessing. Compassionate Father, this morning we pray especially on behalf of two of our members, Rose and Lori Milton, provide healing and relief according to your infinite wisdom and boundless mercy. Grant patient endurance if their sickness must continue, and help them find true spiritual strength through Jesus and his cross during this time of weakness. By the work of the Holy Spirit, teach them to trust in your forgiveness, grace, and love. Amen. And now I invite you to join with me in our special intercessory prayer for Mother's Day. A wife of noble character, who can find? She is worth far more than rubies.
Her husband has full confidence in her and lacks nothing of value.
She brings him good, not harm, all days of her life.
She selects the soul and flax and works with eager hands.
But she is like a merchant of ships, bringing her food from afar.
She gets up while it is still dark. She provides food for her family and portions for her servant girls.
She considers a field and buys it. Out of her earnings, she plants a vineyard.
She sets about her work vigorously. Her arms are strong for her tasks.
She sees that her trading is profitable and her lamp does not go out at night.
In her hand, she holds the spindle.
She opens her arms to the poor and extends her hands to the needy. She makes coverings for her bed. She is clothed in fine linen and purple.
Her husband is respected at the city gate, where he takes his seat among the elders of the land.
She makes linen garments and sells them, and supplies the merchants with sashes.
She is clothed with strength and dignity. She can laugh at the days to come.
She speaks with wisdom, and faithful instruction is on her tongue.
She watches over the affairs of her household and does not need breath.
Her children arise and call her blessed. Her husband also, and he praises her. Many women do noble things, but you surpass them all.
Charm is deceptive, and beauty is fleeting, but the woman who fears the Lord is to be praised. Give her the reward she earned, and let her works bring her praise at the city gate.
The God of qualities of the woman described in Proverbs 31 are born of her faith in God, saving grace in Christ Jesus. That great faith is expressed in the words of the women chosen by God to be the mother of our Savior.
My soul glorifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God, my Savior, for he has been mindful of the humble state of his servant. From now on, all generations will call me blessed, for the Mighty One has done great things for me. Holy is his name. His mercy extends to those who fear him from generation to generation.
Your love, your patience, your gentle teaching, your healing touch, your faithfulness, your devotion to God, all these have shaped us. We praise God for our mothers and for all who have been like our mothers to us. God bless you, and may this day be a happy one. Please be seated. This time we now invite the Sunday school to come forward for an amen. The Lord Jesus Christ, the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body, which was given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Then he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you all.